Hey guys, and welcome back to Casual Cognition, the channel where I discuss Jungian functions and sometimes other psychological topics. So I'm trying to do this thing where on the weekends I'm gonna talk a bit about some random topics that are kind of in the psychological field, while during the week I'm gonna be mostly talking about MBTI topics, Jungian functions, kind of functions, whatever. So today I wanted to discuss something that's very, very important and near and dear to heart, and that's the topic of healthy emotional boundaries. Now, I know most of you are on this channel because you're interested in personality typing, and I swear this is actually related. If you're one of those people who has always been confused about whether they're an FI user or an FE user, this video might explain why you might be having some troubles deciphering that. I personally think that you can only figure out your kind of type if you have healthy emotional boundaries. So I guess I should start off by talking about what healthy emotional boundaries are. And that's basically when you consciously realize and subconsciously believe that you yourself are responsible for your own emotions, whereas other people, they are responsible for their own emotions. And narcissism and codependency, they're really two sides of the same coin, where for codependents, basically what's happening is that they believe that they are responsible for other people's emotions plus their own emotions, whereas narcissists on the other side of the coin believe that they are not responsible for other people's emotions, but they're not responsible for their own emotions either. Other people are responsible for their emotions. So I was actually codependent for a really long time. I was codependent for like 21 years, and I didn't know until I happened to go to therapy. Actually, I went to several therapists for a short time period, and none of them really figured out that I had this problem. I guess I was hiding it pretty well. But finally, the last therapist that I saw him when I was 21, and he figured out this problem. And it's really hard to overcome these subconscious patterns that have been, I guess, set when you were little. But I think after that, I'm like 90% over it, maybe. I still have some codependent tendencies, especially, you know, recently with Alex leaving and all of that just ruptured all of my emotions and overturned a lot of these like negative emotions. And a lot of my old tendencies kind of came back a little bit, but I feel like I'm almost over it. So I guess I'll start off by talking about codependency, because I feel like that is the one that most people will relate to more. And I see a lot of people thinking that they're FE because they are codependent, because unfortunately a lot of stereotypical descriptions of FE and the definition of codependency sound eerily similar. And I don't think that FE is predisposed to codependency at all, but it's just like the definitions are kind of unclear. Living life as a codependent is not fun. It kind of feels like you're walking on eggshells all the time. Just, you're responsible for yourself, but you're responsible for everyone else around you, everyone who's ever interacted with you. If someone beside you is sad and you've talked to that person, boom, it's like it's suddenly my fault that that person is sad. I'll give you some subtle examples maybe of codependency, so you can tell that maybe you have this issue. Before I went to therapy, I always had trouble picking a movie. Like, whenever me and a group of friends were going to a movie, they would take turns choosing the movie. And when it was my turn to choose, it's kind of ironic because I was a film major and I'm so passionate about movies. I had trouble picking a movie that I haven't seen, because I felt like if the movie turns out to be really bad, then I would be responsible for other people's bad feelings. Or even if the movie was good, but like the friends didn't like it and they felt bored when they were watching the movie, I would feel responsible for their boredom. So yeah, as you can see, like if you go through life like that, you're kind of afraid to do anything, because the movie was kind of a subtle example. I guess it didn't really matter that I never picked a movie, but you know, when you extrapolate that onto everyday life and conversations, I also had trouble picking where to go. Like, whenever someone was like, oh, what did you want to do tonight when we hang out? I never picked an activity. I was always like, oh, wherever, whatever you want to do, or wherever you want to go for dinner. It's because I was so afraid of choosing something that the other person wouldn't like. You know, the healthy approach to this would be to trust that the other person can take responsibility for their emotions. So for example, if I say like, oh, let's go to a Thai restaurant, I am thinking that everyone's just like helplessly gonna follow me to the Thai restaurant and not be responsible for them at all. Basically, like, I'm treating everyone like children, right? Like, if I trust that everyone's an adult, then if someone really doesn't like Thai food, then they will tell me that, like, hey, actually I'm allergic, or actually I'm not into Thai food, can we go somewhere else? And I would be like, yes, unless I'm a jerk and insist. So being codependent, you're really inhibited. I would actually say that even people might even type themselves as introverted because of codependency. And I guess that's because you mull over in your mind over and over again what the effects of your actions are gonna be. Not like in a predictive sense, like if I study today, then I'll ace the exam tomorrow. Not in that sense, but like, oh, if I say this, then the other person will feel this way. If I don't say that, then the other person will feel another way. And it's all these like mind games that you play with yourself, and you're just not trusting that other people can take care of their emotions. Like, if you pick a bad movie and they're bored, you know, now I trust them that they can take care of their boredom. You know, like, I don't have to fix their boredom for them. They can doze off. They can think about something while watching the movie. They can be like, hey, I really don't like this, I'm gonna leave in the middle of the movie, would you like to come with me, right? So yeah, that's basically codependency in a nutshell. Now, let's move on to narcissism. I think I have hope for the narcissist. I think I read somewhere once, I'm not sure how true this is, but it basically said that there's no cure for narcissism. It's commonly accepted that narcissism lessens in intensity as you grow older, but there's basically no cure. I'm not sure about that. I have like too much hope in humanity. So narcissism is basically when you don't realize that you're responsible for your emotions and you think everyone else is. So how this usually manifests is because you can't control your emotions, because you're not responsible for them, you try to control other people. The narcissist is the one who says, you are always sad and that makes me feel like I'm a bad friend, you know, with the implication being like, stop being so sad. By doing that, I can control my emotions. You're trying to tell the other person to be like a happy-go-lucky person so then you can in turn be a happy-go-lucky person. Also, you know, it's negative stuff like, you going out with your other friends make me really jealous and therefore you can't go out with your other friends. It's always you doing X makes me feel Y, right? And then there's no unpacking of that makes me feel part. It's just like X equals Y. It's like why? Yeah, they don't realize that their own emotions like originate from themselves, from within. So I guess if a codependent is treating everyone else as a child, it can be said that a narcissist is basically like emotionally a child but treating everyone else like they are their guardian. So the child expects, and rightfully expects, their mom to like take care of their emotions, take care of their needs. And it's kind of the same with narcissists for the people who are close to them. So yeah, I know there's the traditional meaning of a narcissist, which comes from narcissist. I think that's like some sort of myth where a guy like was so enraptured with his reflection that he fell in. So it's like a huge self-absorption, selfishness, vanity. Okay, so that's one definition of narcissism. But the other one is actually very socially dependent. Like, a narcissist would have a hard time existing in a vacuum. Basically, a narcissist, like, they need the emotions of other people. They need other people to like emotionally take care of them. And it's weird to talk about narcissists like that because society has such a negative image of them, and it's not undeserved. You know, like, most narcissists are very controlling, they're really demanding, they're kind of immature. They don't realize the effect that they have on others, but whenever others are mean to them, they like feel it hypersensitively. But all of that is basically coming from a place of real vulnerability. Like, they have no control over their emotions, and that's really scary. So I guess I should give some examples of narcissists. When I was little, whenever I had a negative emotion, I mean, sometimes it was because of my mom, sometimes it was because of some random thing that happened at school and I'd be crying or whatever. Yeah, my mom would be like, I feel like a bad mom because you're crying, or I feel like you're ungrateful to me because you're crying, you're showing negative emotions and I feel like a failure. So like, I guess up until recently, I felt like I couldn't really show negative emotions. So, you know, even though I was a dominant FI user and showing my emotions came naturally to me, that was really, really suppressed, because every time as a child when I showed negative emotions, my mom would have a really negative reaction. Basically, you expect the parent to take care of the emotions of the child. Like, if the child is really sad, the parent should comfort them. But we had a reverse parenting thing going on, where when I felt sad, instead of comforting me, my mom would make it about her, and therefore I had to comfort her. I had to be like, no, you're not a bad mom. I'm sorry I cried. I am grateful. I'm like, everything's great. Why that example is relevant is because, oh, this is like probably the most important part of the video and why you should like really, really try to figure out if you have one of these things and try to fix it if you do. Because we learn love from our parents. Like, our impression of love comes from how our parents loved us, right? So if you have a parent who's narcissistic or codependent, then that's gonna be your structure of love, and you're gonna seek that out, because when you're an adult and you're seeking a relationship and you're seeking love from that relationship, that's gonna be like your motto of love. And I did do this mistake. I did repeat that narcissistic codependent relationship in my first romantic relationship. It was really unfortunate, and yeah, people are like doomed to repeat these patterns unless you like you take care of it. And I thought it was completely normal that my mom was like expecting me to take care of her emotions. I thought it was like normal that my ex was like having this whole world revolve around him and that I had to constantly take care of his feelings. You know, now that I've stepped back and thought about like, oh, what about me? I'm an individual too. It sounds kind of ridiculous, but when you're in that pattern all throughout your childhood, it can be really, really insidious, and you might be in this pattern and not even realize it. So yeah, please figure out if you have one of these issues with emotional boundary, and if you do, like, try to get help, because knowledge is power, and if you don't have this knowledge, you will like repeat this over and over again, and it's really not fun. Having healthy emotional boundaries is so fun. And I guess if you're not currently in a place to get help, or is not super convenient right this moment, then I would say just repeat, I am responsible for my own emotions. You're responsible for your own emotions. No is a complete sentence. Yeah, okay, sounds silly, but I really have to like do this, because, okay, even for like Alex leaving, like, I had to say this so often, because I guess that was kind of intense, and maybe these tendencies come out more when you're in a very intense experience. So all of my like codependent things came out. I was thinking like, I'm responsible for her actions, I'm responsible for her feelings. I didn't even know what her feelings were, but like, I assume negative if she left. I'm responsible for her negative feelings, I'm a bad person, I don't know how to fix this. And it's like, I couldn't figure out that like, she's responsible for her actions and feelings. And you know, a lot of people told me that I had to like do some self-care after that, and you guys are so right. Like, I was supposed to take care of my feelings, so like, who's responsible for me not being a depressed mess after that? Me. Like, only me. And I guess hopefully my loved ones can offer me comfort and support, but they're not really responsible. And I'm an adult now, so my parents are not responsible either. So I really had to like take time for that self-care. And I guess right about now, you might be seeing how this is related to FI and FE. Like, all these immature and I think horrible stereotypical explanations of FI and FE exist out there, where FI is just like selfish, la 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 la, I just do my own thing, I don't care about anyone. That sounds a lot like a narcissist. And FE being, ooh, I am a poor sponge and I like suck up the emotions of everyone and I'm responsible for the emotional atmosphere. You know, I see why they hyperbolize those explanations because it might make it a bit easier for people to understand. But the true FI and FE, they're really, really nuanced. And I'm not going to get into it in this video, but I do have videos on FI versus FE. Like, I have lots of videos on FI versus FE. I'll link those in the description if you want to watch the, you know, the real difference between FI and FE, not just these like stereotypical behavioral manifestations. So figure out your emotional boundaries first and then figure out your kind of type. I promise you that emotional boundaries is more important than kind of type. But if you've gotten your emotional boundaries sorted out and you just want to know your kind of type, I have a lot of videos to help with that. But if you would like me to personally type you, I do offer that service on my website, kindofaids.com. Thank you for watching this video. I hope everyone out there takes care of themselves as I have done over the last month. Have a great day and I'll see you next time.